by Bob, and that was when we were on STV Glasgow. And that and another song he wrote, I've had over 100,000 hits in that Google thing, whatever you call it. But anyway, I hope you've all had a wee small libation. I had some water. But I'll get you in the bar. This second half is a wee bit more, shall we say, factual than the first half. Because for the past, I don't know, 28, 29 years, all everybody wants to know is, how did you and Gilbert get together? How did you and Gilbert get together? We got together, funnily enough, I used to go to see Robert. He used to play in a pub called McNeese at Egham Toll. Kenny Dodd sitting up there. Wishes were all at her. And I used to go to McNeese with my former husband. This is my present husband, but with my former husband. And he used to get singers up at the time. And they just say, Mimi, go up, give us a song, go up, give us a song. But man, they, well, you know what I'm like, my nerves, but even then it was worse. So I'd got up to sing, and a tablet would stick to my teeth. And I would get it, memories, like the corners of my mind. They had to push me to get me up. They kind of shot me up. But Robert then started working in the Cumberland Arms and the Gorbals with. This is like mine house, I keep losing the remote control. With this lady here. This is Mae McCracken. Mae's to blame for me doing what I do now. In fact, Mae, 20 odd years ago, used to actually sing in the Waterloo, before the Waterloo is the way it is now. And her boy used to play keyboards and used to set up in the Windy Ledge. And she used to stand and talk the fag machine and belt it out. We worked in the Alpine Lodge at the time. We used to go round in my break to see Mae McCracken and she would come in to see us. But she started working anyway with Robert in a Cumberland Arms on a Sunday afternoon. And she had a road show. And she'd all these fabulous singers. Rose Hamilton, Big George Young, Jim Downey, Big Peter Bolton, great singers. So she brought them out to the Cumberland Arms on a Sunday afternoon to start working with Robert. And she said to him, is there anybody comes in to sing with you that you would invite down? So he said, oh, there's this lassie. Mae Murray. Because he was the only person that ever called me by my married name. People don't understand. I was born Mae Muller and I got married and became Mae Murray. And then then I married Robert Muller. So anyhow. So I guess a real angle. He says, you want to fancy coming on a Sunday afternoon? He says, I'm going to start working with this woman, Mae McCracken. So me and Maria Lockheed, my pal, was a real man this Sunday, and I was quite adventurous in my outfits. And I walked in and I had a white satin coat on down to my ankles, and a big turban in my head, and a big diamond pin. A Sunday afternoon. And my crack up went. She told me after it, she said, when you walked in, I thought, what is that? I think it is at 1 o'clock on a Sunday. Quite a bit like that. She says, but then when you opened your mouth to sing, I thought, that'll do for me. So anyway, she gave me the confidence to do it today. And she'd asked me to join their concert party. It's 30. It's over, but we're together near 30. It's over 30 years ago. And they used to work for the PETA Institute in Hungary for profoundly disabled kids. And we used to work for the Dolphin Foundation to send kids to swim with the dolphins. So they asked me to join up and I said, all right, and I loved it because I wasn't getting paid for it. So if I was shy, they couldn't moan and they weren't giving me any money, so I was fine. But for that, I started getting offered cabaret gigs. And it was before karaoke's were invented. And so you had to go and play with a keyboard player or a band. Or in one day I went to Bell's Hill and it was a man with an accordion and a guy with a drum. And I thought, oh, I can't do this, I hated it. And one time I was in Stonehouse Violet and I went in. And I used to sing with another, I used to go up and sing him noon again then, and I would go and sing with Andy Boyle noon again. And I said, I'm getting offered work. I said, could you do music for me? So Andy did all the dots and Robert did chord sheets. So I'd go to these gigs with all my stuff. And I went into Stonehouse Hall at this day. And I'm up, trying to be nice. And I'm giving me man my stuff. And he went, oh, hold on, hey. And he said, I have no glasses. Hold on a minute. Oh, I've come out without my glasses. I can't read any of that. And I thought, I said, well, what? I says, a day, babe, and D. And I says, a day, I will survive in G minor. And I heard this as a whistling noise. And I went, what's that? He went, oh, he said, my battery's weighing us here now. So he had a deaf, blind keyboard player, right? And he had insult to injury. The drummer came here and he went, you'll not need me for a couple of minutes, and I'm away for a pish. So that's how I started talking a lot of rubbish for Robin, because I had 2 45 minutes to fill in with somebody going to play 4 songs. But anyway, then I started to do talent competitions. Now, I'm going to be rude, because I know he's in. This was before Simon Cowell entered, I'm sorry. Before, when talent was talent and Simon Cowell hadn't killed it for everybody then. But I used to go and do talent contests, and I think I did 12 or 14 this year, and I won every one of them, excuse me. And it was great. And through that, I was entered into a big, big contest. It was on called Scotland's New Faces. And I was entered into it. And do you ever, there's one night in your whole life and you just wish you could turn the clock back and blot it right in your memory. That was my night. Because that was the night I met him. My sister, Jim. I met him that night. He won the raffle and I won the competition. It's 30 odd years later and he's still a hump for my back, but pal. But the prize money all the years ago, it was a lot of money then, it was £2,000, and the opportunity to go and be the support act to the Supremes, when I was all taking on by myself. So I guess I went to the theatre a couple of months later to do the gig, and took the boys with me. I think I was about 7, France about 4 or something. And it was December, and there'd been a pantomime on the theatre. So I'm running about with Daffy Duck's legs and E.T.'s heat and getting 40s to it and doing all the daff carry on with the veins. And I thought, the rehearsals had finished, and I thought, Chris, I better feed them before I go on the stage. So I'm coming down the back stairs, and there's a wee boy sitting. I came down and I went, all right, son. Looked at him like that. I went, we getting up for Santa? They looked at me as if I was daft. I went to get something nice for your Christmas. He shouted, Mom, this lady does know how to speak properly. It was Mary Wilson at the Supremes' as wee boy. Now, this was before McDonald's or KFC was ever invented. But see, when I went like him, but you want to eat out the wimpy, you knew what I said then. I was 27 and a half quid to feed the wee fuck. But anyway. No long after that, a pal of mine, Robert Austin, two pals in fact, Robert Austin and Cole McKee, who knew sings under Chris Muller, Robert phoned me up, and it was just when the AIDS epidemic hit, and he says to me, mate, could you get a keyboard player? He says, and try and raise some money, because a lot of people were getting treated in Rock Hill Hospital, and they didn't get any independent funding, so they needed funds, needed money. So I phoned Robert Muller up and explained it to him. And he went, I didn't bother. And I went, it's a gay bar, put the phone down. And he was like, ah, it's a gay bar, I didn't know what a gay bar was. And at that time, honestly, nobody worked in gay bars, nobody would touch gay bars. I don't know if it was ignorance, AIDS, or if it was just a fear, the unknown kind of thing. But anyway, I tell you, this is a bit more factual. But anyway, we started that night, we did a Monday night, it was supposed to just be the one night, but it was so well supported because that community are amazing. It went for that one night to one a month, and then it became too busy for Austin's, so we took it to the Renfrew Ferry, and for the Renfrew Ferry, it became the start of the original gay ball. And the ethos of the gay ball has always been, everybody does it for nothing. But it got too big. It went to the, when the Central Hotel in Albany were getting mobbed and were selling 600-700 tickets. We couldn't cope with it. So they brought on a committee, which then became the Glasgow Bars AIDS Welfare Fund. And they brought in these guys from Edinburgh and different places, who then decided if you pay peanuts, you get monkeys. So you need to pay a lot of money to get a big act. But I'm sorry, the monkeys that we're talking about then were Elaine C. Smith, who did it for nothing, Brenda Cochrane, who did it for nothing, Camden Bar, everybody did it for the charity. But this committee came in and they said, no, you need. So they booked the Nolans. So we were in the Albany Hotel, doing the dog's body about as usual, setting up the gear and getting everything organised. And the Nolans come in. Now they'd paid £4,000 over the years ago. And there was an old Nolan. And I had two dummy Nolans. I don't know who they were. There was only three of them, but we'd paid for four. Because we'd paid four flights and four bedrooms. So I said, hey, I kind of shut my mouth a bit, excuse me. Where's your other Nolan? She went, what? So where's your other Nolan? She went, oh, her granny died. I went, if it's a granny, it's your mum, it's her granny. I went, she went, we've got another two dummy Nolans. I tell you, I was in the mood that night, and it wasn't for dancing. But anyway. So the politics were all upside down, and it all disbanded, and the gay ball kind of fell by the wayside a couple of years later. It was about 7 years ago, we were out from AIDS Valley, and we met up with Mark Sherry Trifon. I said, do you think we could maybe try and reinstate the gay ball? So we thought, we'll see what we can do. So the first year we went to the Crown Plaza and it was mobbed. So we needed to make it a bigger place. So for the last 5 years we've done it in Hilton and it's been brilliant, it's been great. But then I think we're going to have to go to the Thistle next year because I'm getting all sorts of dogs abuse because it's sold out in 3 weeks and we've not got any tickets left and Hoffies can't probably get in. But you'll get in next year because I think we're going to go to the Thistle next year. But anyway, fair there, Robert and I started working full time. And I think we did like 100, because pubs were rammed then, so we did like 101 gigs and then a night half, and then 60 odd gigs and then a night half. And doing as many gigs as that and going to as many places, you meet, how could you call them? Crackpots. Company included, of course. Like a guy came up once and he went, "Bind me, doll. Tell me something, doll. I'm for peace. Like, bind me, doll." He says, "I don't like pianos." He says, "I'm a guitar man." He went, "See him, he's brilliant on a piano." I went, "Thanks very much. And see you, doll. See when you sing, you sound as if you've got a pair of bus." Go like, thanks very much. Okay, let's see, if you'd a pair of boot them, but I feel like the chicken. Then another wee man came up and said, "Tell you something, I watch that telly. There's a lot of shite in that telly, you should be on it." That's a compliment, Glasgow. I mind, years ago, we did a gig up in a bingo hall in Fife. It's marvellous. We up in Fife, and there was 56 women folded us up in a bus to Postal in the fishing village. And they've come up along with us. It was a great night, great gig. We all got old guns blazing. And we used to sell CDs at the time. So at the end of the night, I'm up the CDs and this wee woman from Fife came up, she went, "Oh, Ken Henyard, bro." I went, "Well, thanks very much." "Oh, no, Ken Henyard, bro, but they're your night. Well, they can have a sing up there." As soon as you get by Bayliss and Lights, they all start to sing. And then Bayliss and are no right, but anyhow. "Well, I'll get the lobby, you get your boyfriend up the street." She went, "Oh, Ken Henyard, bro, oh, yeah, bro." And I went, "Thanks very much, but this big..." I can say it now, fat woman. This big woman that came up in the bus with Postal went, "They're bro! I'm no bro at all, I'm brilliant! They're brilliant, there's 56 of us came in the bus to see them, they're brilliant! You never seen them before?" And we went, "Oh no, Ken, never seen them, never seen them, heard all about them, never seen them, never seen them." She meant you would never have known her last year. Tell the woman what size were you? She went, Linda. I went, she went, sure. He says, she's travelled all 8 miles for the postal because she likes you. He says, what do you think the ones that hate you are saying about you? But she's bumming you. So no long after that, we sat and we thought, what can we do? We'll do a wee something named Elsie's done. So there was two lasses used to come to see us at Dragon Austin's, and one of them worked in the SCCC. And she said, do you never fancy trying to do the SCCC? And I went, you're having a laugh. She went, no, honest. She went, I've got a cult following. She went, because I go to different pubs all over the place. She went, you see the same people all the time because they travel to see you. She went, so I think you should try and do it. Well, Mr. Positive over there decides to, we'll do it. So we booked it. We did it. There's the proof coming up. We sold it out. It was a brilliant, brilliant night. I loved it. £2,000 it cost for that advert. It was sold out by that time. We didn't need to put the advert. But my nerves were shattered. I was cutting about the tune. We had two big plastic bags full of tickets, right? Which I always do. Like, I get into trouble in here after the mom. No, this now. We went into scenes with Raymond one Sunday. And she was very polite. She's a wee drunk now. And she went, do you never get embarrassed selling tickets out of an Asda? I went, no, because the Asda Pope doesn't want commission. My nerves were shot. The night we did it, I was in the toilet going, Tina Turner said, I pee in here, Jesus Christ. And when we did it on the Thursday night, Paul McCartney had been there on the Saturday. They were taking his name down. And I went, going to leave it up. It looks as if you've done a giggle on me. I'm going to just leave his name up beside yours. And he'd 17 low loaders on the Saturday. And we drove in, yeah, inside where we were in, we were in van, right? I was like, him, Robert, we're off. We're not. We did it. That was a proof. But my nerves were shot during it. And I had a dog, Rocky. She'd been caught gawking. And Rocky got attacked with an Alsatian. Oh. I thought, oh no. It was even worse than that. And I took him to the vet. So they gave me tablets for him and they gave me cream. And it said on it, for animal use only, not for human consumption. So well, I've come home for a gig one night, get me sherry on me, and I've put down, get him his tablets, I've put his cream on. And I thought, good washing, I thought, oh, no bother washing my hands. So I was like, broke out in a rash, in my chest, me doing it about there, right? So I've put all the cream on, and on my life, 2 days later, not a mark in the rash. Certainly it's left me with two side effects. Keep pissing up was and I can lick my nerves. You've probably gone and mentioned, I don't know, but but at that time people were getting to know our name. And I was in the house one night and the phone went, could I speak to Mae Miller, please? I went, speaking? This is the GLC. I went, pardon? It's the Greater London Council. I went, oh, I don't know. I went, yes, can I help you? She said, we're doing an AIDS benefit and we hear you do a lot of work for up in Glasgow and we'd like to know if you'd like to come down and represent Scotland. And I said, could you tell me the date? So whatever the date was, she'd tell me. And I went, hold on, I'll check my diary. Well, I am, we're gone! I can't bring my day, we're gone. I said, that'd be lovely, thank you. I said, put that date in the diary. And it was before emails and all that. I said, she said, I'll send you a letter of confirmation. I went, thanks very much. So about 3 or 4 weeks later, I hadn't heard it, and then Freddie Mercury died, so it was all went tits up, and it never happened. So we forgot about it. And I'd been all excited, you know, but that's these things are. So one day I was in the house and the phone went, picked up, speak to me, Miller, please. I said, speaking, this is a GLC. Robert, put it back in a letter. I said, yes. Could you do a gig for us on the 26th of August? I said, same routine. Yeah, hold on a minute. I'm gone. I said, right. I said, I put it in the diary. She said, it was emails, but email you. And I went, thanks very much. I said, could I have a contact number in case I have to get in touch with anyone? And it was before 0141. She went, 041-332. And I went, excuse me. I said, GLC, I said, Greater London Council, that's not a London phone number. She went, no, we're not the Greater London Council. She went, well, the gay lesbian centre on Dixon Street. But then we booked the pavilion. We did that twice. We've done the City Halls. We've done the Mitchell Theatre umpteen times. Now we do, up here in East Kilbride with the Divas along the road, and we've done a few things in here. But when we did the pavilion the first time, there was a guy came to see us, and his name was Ian Morrow. He was a record producer. And he produced, he worked for Trevor Horn, and then produced for the Wait and Seal and ELO or Emerson Lake and Palmer or whoever they were, I don't know who they were. But he produced for all them. And he came up to Scotland and he was looking for three or four acts who didn't have a recording contract. So he singled us out, and Hue and Cry at the time, and Capper Caley, different types of music. And he'd heard a lot of Robert's original stuff, and we had a meeting with him. And he said, there's an album's worth there. He says, we'd like to take you on. He said, the first album, you'll not make any money. The second album, he said, we'll put you out on tour. But they didn't want us to tour up here or whatever. They wanted to go to America and Canada and do all the expat stuff. He said, and with the third album, you could be very wealthy. But things weren't, politics weren't right, and he'd a wife and three wains, and I had Jamie and two boys. So we had to say no to it. But, sometimes I think, if we'd have took it, this could have been the Albert Hall, you were sat in this time. We'd upset and he's no bright. It's funny, I'll no go by. This is the song that Ian Morrow heard that he liked. And this is a song written by Bob. Oh, right hospice. Thank you. Anyway, things were going great. Me and Jamie bought our first flat in Albert Avenue, Queen's Park, up a close. And we moved in, and I was only there 2 days. The door went. I was a bit my granny, I never did a bell. The door went. And there was a woman stoning with a cake. And I went, thanks very much. So I'm only coming doing for the welcome you in the close. And I went, thanks very much. She went, I'm a Maria. She went, I'm staying in the tub. I said, pleased to meet you, Maria. She went, I don't know if you noticed, she said, I'm Italian. She went, I'm only learning a language. I said, that's good. I said, how long have you been here? She went, I was moving the clothes when Luigi, my boy, was one. I said, what age is he now? She went, 22. I thought, let's take you out a little language. And she says to me, I see you going out every night. You go in a red one. And sometimes you get a blue car. She's very gone. She's going to work. Going to work? I said, Dad. She said, sometimes you don't come in at 2 in the morning. I'm coming from my work. Where'd you work? I said, all over the place, everywhere. She went, well, sometimes you go in a blue car and you come by in a black one. And sometimes you go in a black suit, come back with a blue dress and I thin your hair. I said, I know, for my work. She said, you're a nurse? No. I never tell her who I was. She thought I was the lady of the night. She thought I was a prostitute. She must have been talking to the Irish woman across the road and says to her, who you think that woman's moving in the clothes and every night she's going every night, different persons everywhere? Didn't come in at 2 in the morning, 3 in the morning. Sometimes she come in, she's singing, I don't know, she's drunk, I don't know. The Irish woman went, well, I wouldn't be born with that. That's not the least of your worries. She said, because I tell you, it's our boys. What do you mean, our boys? She went, you can't see them. She went, because you're staying up the stairs. She went, I'm right across the road. She went, they come in from the school. She went, and the wee one goes up the stair, and then the big one comes down, and he goes, be in a bike. And the bike's got a bag in it. And the wee ones, and now I had done, never get any money. I done run plastic blinds that used to roll up and down, right? She went, I watched them. She went, the wee one stays in the house and the big one goes out. And then the wee one, the blind goes down. And then one blind goes kind of there, another one comes right down. Another blind goes up. And then about an hour later, the big one comes back with a bag and the bike. And then all the blinds go down and I think that means the drugs are in. Francis had an Atari, and it was a bay windy, so the sun would come in that way or that way, so he'd pull the blind down to block out the sun, and James would go back down to the gardens and do a paper run with his bike in his bag, and come back up, and then they'd put all the blinds down, because two of them were playing the Atari. One never made them any the wiser, I just left. Then I met her one day in Vicky Road. I went, oh Maria, how are you doing? She says, oh, I'm deeply, I'm going to be a granny. I said, hey, I mean, is that your Luigi's wife having a baby? She says, she pregnant. Oh, I said, that's great, what does she do? Oh, she'll not be due fed, so about 2 months, it's in 9 weeks. I went, oh, that's great, everything going great. She went, it's okay, but she's a vegetable. What do you say? And I went, she's a vegetable. Yeah, she's a vegetable. I went, but is she going to be all right? Oh, she said she'd be fine, she starts to eat meat. That was 10 years later, she was still there in the land. Anyway, back to my memory books. Let's see what we've got in here. Oh, yeah. Here we go. Oh, here we go. My world famous skirt. This skirt Wah. My pal, Mary Queen. Mary had a big accident when she was young. She was burnt a fire. But don't feel sorry for her. Because I've struggled all my life, my weight. But they used to take her into Gartnavel and cut the fat out because her skin didn't the streets. I hated her. But anyway. So this time, she'd been in and she said, I'm on a fat out and chair. That's nearly half a stone, she's never had to do a bit. So she's the dad done, so she can't carry anything. And her sister Ellen, she's been in and had a hysterical rectum done, right? So I said, she fancy going a wee quiet week. We'll go away for a wee week. She went, aye, right. I said, you're going to convalesce with your Adams and Ellen's. They'll say the bad word, she's knackered. I said, we'll go for a wee quiet week. Go to Villamoura, in Portugal. It's quiet. I said, no, we'll take your old ma, Bella, she was 81, and her older handicapped Uncle John, he was 78, and old Molly Gawkin, she was 85. So we'll take the old ones and we'll have a wee quiet week. So her sister Isabel's coming with us or not. Against the Portugal. They were steaming. Marvellous for the fall. In fact, on the way out on the plane, there was a man. We were sitting here. There was a man at our back. And he gets headphones. We get the head, used to get headphones. So he's put the headphone on. And he was one of the one with the blonde streaks and all that, and the shirt all and doing it there. He's getting up all that. But he's put a set of headphones. Now, God bless him, Mary's my pal for 40 or 50 years. She's not got any ears, right? But anyway. She was jealous of me because I could carry an earring. But anyway. We were sitting in a plane, and this fella, ding ding, because I set a headphones, please, we'll get some headphones. So what's mean I was gabbing away a wee couple of vodkas. Ding, ding. So the lass came up, she went, something wrong, sir? He went, there's only one of these headphones working. She went, well, no problem, sir. So she took my information goes. Chat, 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 chat. Ding, ding. So the lass comes up again, he went, excuse me. He said, these headphones are not working. Three times. So the next time the lass had come up, ding, ding, Mary turned and she went, ding, ding! Are you dinging it? She went, see you've got 3 years, you get my nerves. Do you know how there's maybe you're needing them syringe to get that lass running up and doing there all day? She went, no, I can't wear, I need to shove them up my beak, I've not got any. You know the guy in a hook is going to start like the whole way, Portugal. I digress. We get to Portugal and we're steaming. So, going to tell me where it is with Aldrin's. Well, yous are no, because some of yous are. He's wanting to buy dishcloths and lace table covers for you know, your holidays. Everyone in the market being hurst, you know, carrying all these towels. So I get to this robustus kind of a stall thing. It was a lassie stall in the Portuguese accent. She was like, you buy some stuff. Well, she said, I don't know what she said. But she'd done this beautiful suit. And as you can see, this gets like a big giant tea bag. And the tote to match it was all thingy there. Kind of a full, but then that was all lacy and lacy sleeves. So I says to Mary, I want my money. She went, who's for? I went, me. She went, that lass is a size 10. I was a bit chuffed then. She went, that lass is a t-. I went, awesome, I like it. So I bought it. Right, so I took it back to the apartment and I put it in the wardrobe. So the morning we were coming home, I've got to carry all the cases doing because she's not well with her hair, and the other one's all trying to drop. So I was up to pack my case and I was in the wardrobe and I thought, drunk, I'm going for my skirt on. So I've got it on, honest to God, I was like a pun of port lights and that. So I came to the stair with the case. She went, where are you going with that one? I don't know what the airport. I don't know, it's like a name. I've got a shepherd, I've got Uncle John, I've got Bella, I've got Molly, she's McMary's steaming, I've got Hotel, I've got through the airport and get it with her. So Mary went like that. Oh no! Where was it? And I was like, she went, your hair. I went, what's up with my hair? Your wrist skirt's got a wee bit in it to cover your vanity. Your hair. I hair. I thought I'd have spawned it before. Maria, my neighbour would have seen me with that prostitute skirt. So, right about that time, well, I was having a rare dirty myself, but round about that time, Jamie and I split up. I'm going to have another night and tell you about him, but never mind. Jamie and I split up and I moved to, so I moved to where I am now. Near Twinnogia. But the boys are forever saying to me, how do you not move? How do you not move to a different area? Because we've got a lot of mental cases around the boots, but I like where I live and I've got great, great neighbours, And I was not long in the house. And the door went one night, door swings open, and in comes your John. Right, Cuddles. Right, Cuddles, I need a CD in his song. And he says to me, gonna learn a song. I went, I love this, my favourite song, gonna learn a song. And I says to him, aye, all right, learn it. So this here, this is Robert's painting of your John, that's your John. And this is John's song.
Some ungodly reason we just can't let it.
took me over a year to sing the song because 3 weeks after he went to Spain for his 40th birth, he never come back. And it was only 6 weeks after that my younger son was attacked in Tenerife, and I was out again for 6 months or something. And I thought I'll never sing again in my life. But that's so stupid. I've got loads of pals, with loads and loads of support all during that time. And it took a while, but I eventually got back to my work. Because my work, in case you don't know, this is my work. Yeah. And we've had great support for loads and loads of people. But you know when you lose somebody, you're looking for something, So it was lassies used to come to see us. He used to go to the spiritualist church. And I used to laugh at them. I said, it's a lot of rubbish. She went, no, man, just go, you get stuff. I said, all right. So I was the sportsman one Friday night and had a right good drink, man. Saturday morning, I thought, I'm going to go to that spiritualist church. It was right beside the High Court. So I was there, 8:30 in the morning. I'd been on the Swally all night, so I've got eyes like dog's balls. So I goes in. And we're all sitting. In fact, a wee man, we're all talking. I thought he said he'd met Elton John, and I've jumped on it because that's mad. I've only got one ambition. I've got two. One's to be a size six, but I don't think I'll get that one. And the other one's to meet Elton John. So I thought he said he'd met Elton John. And I went, where did you meet him? He went, no, I didn't meet him, but I've spoken to him. And I went, where? Elton John? He went, no, Elton John, Bible John. Tell me, go tell a boss. But anyway, 2 minutes in this wee room, I'm thinking it's £8 or something. And he says to me, now my eyes are doing the other like art after you know, swallow on it. He said, I've got a man here and he's telling me you like a wee drink. I would have knocked him down with smell off my breath. And I went, aye, well aye. He said, do you know a Jim? Or a Jimmy? Or a James? I says to him, well, we live in Glasgow, so who does he know a Jimmy? Or a Jimmy? Or a James? He went, oh, we can't go anywhere with that then. He said, does Tenerife mean anything yet? I went, I go my holidays to Tenerife. Oh, we can't go anywhere with that then. And I had the long split up for Jamie Murray, and he went, have you ever felt a presence in your bedroom during the night? I went, well, no, for a while. He said, well, you're going to experience a presence. Get in my nerves by this time. You're going to experience a presence in your bedroom during the night. And then I get flung out. Because I says to him, well, I hope he's young and heavy hung and no floating above the bed. That's not what they expect. But anyway, sorry for getting upset. I did it last night. I thought I'm going to do it the night again, but I did. But anyway, so, as I say, we get loads and loads of support and help from loads and loads of people we've met through this job, people we've had for years, friends that we've met through coming to our gigs, and they became really good pals. Some of yous are in here the night. Some of yous are here in kind of a more ways than one.
Music. Remember the time of the skip?
This is Big Stuart. Stuart Donovan, been my pals for 30 years. That story is Robert Austin had opened a new pub in Kelvin Grove called Baz Jack's. And me, Mary Queen, Ellen, Oz were all up because it was all dark wood and he wanted it all sanded down, but he didn't want to pay him, so we're going about sanding and cleaning, and I'm out weeding the garden. And the guy who was putting the coffee machine in, Robert Austin had gave him tickets to come to the opening night. So every day the guy's in, me and Mary are how right making them tea and blah and putting over there. So he takes the ticket home and he says to his wife, we've been invited to the opening night to buy his jacks. She went, do you think it'll be a good night? He said, I think it'll be quite good. He said, what's that guy, Robert Muller, that's playing it? He went, but it's the cleaner that's singing. But when we left that night at Baez Jack's, as I say, he used to go home. So me and Stuart and Donna were going to Victoria's. So we came out the taxi in Sucky Hall Street, and Big Stuart went, I need to go for a pee. I said, there, skip. I went just at the lane in the back of Victoria's. I went, there, skip. I went, go date up there. And Donna, when she's drunk, she's always need a pee. She went, what's with that? I went, well, you go to the other side of the skip. I went, I'll sit up and keep the edge. So I get myself up the skip. And I'm kind of a balance like that, watching for him to come in. And I saw two rivers of piss just rolling down the street like that. The lad bust out laughing and I went, ha! We're in the skip! Well, somebody put a buffet in it. Had to shout two guys to get me out, and they still let me into Victoria's with tomatoes and cucumbers. They were eating a full buffet off my back. Oh, showing up, here we go, who's here?
Right, Matt, tell the story about the guy that you met on the plane, the guy who knew me and Francis from Tenerife.
It's my James. I was on the plane to meet them, I used to go myself to visit them all the time. So I'm sitting in the plane and maybe one or two Bacardi's a lot, because I used to drink Bacardi when I wasn't drinking, but anyway. So I'm sitting in a plane, no drinking, and there was a guy sitting beside me, blather, 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 so blather me. And he said, whereabouts is it you're going to stay? And I said, well, I'm going to live with one of my boys. Oh, your boys live here? I said, I've been here for years, middle of the day. I said, well, one works in the Pink, and one works in the Drunken Duck. He went, I drink the Drunken Duck. He says, one's your boy? I went, Francis. He went, George Clooney. And I went, what? He went, no, everybody says he looks like George Clooney. I said, I've got two celebrities for sons. I've got George Clooney and I've got Rodney, who only fools and horses. The guy told them and he wasn't happy, Rodney wasn't happy. But that's my boys. Let me see what we've got here.
Maisie! Oh, there's an awful whiff of your damp carpet.
I was just afraid of it in the tub. I could show you the one he done when he was in the tub, but that's for another day. That, well, couldn't do a night without that turning up, no show without punch. Two gay lasses used to come to see us years and years ago, Maggie and Shirley. Shirley's mom christened her Shirley after Shirley Bassey. But she looked more like Shirley Crabtree and Daddy, you know what I mean? She was a bulldog chowing a bar. But they tell me the story when they first met. The first date was in the Waterloo. So they've met in the Waterloo. So Maggie's telling me the story. She went, mate, she said, could smoke in the pub sound. She went, I met Shirley. She went, study at Bournemouth. She says, got a couple of pints of cider. She smoked her roll up. She went, I says to her, Shirley, hold on there a minute. I'm away for a slash. So she says, I went, that wee pushing up. So she says, I've come out. So she smoked her roll up. She says, away. She says, I'm peeing out. She comes back out. And they're storing. She went, I've got turn up. And she went, I was like, I'll have a whiff of a damp carpet here. She went, I can't smell it, Shirley. She went, no, I can't. She went, well, I couldn't put up with that smell. She went, well, we'll go somewhere else. She was living in the Admiral. So Maggie said, I've got a couple of pints of cider, man. Shirley went, that damp carpet smells in here and all. She went, I couldn't smell nothing. I can't smell it anyway. She says, it turned out, when she's went to the toilet in Waterloo, she's went to pull her trousers up and her roll-up fell in her knickers and she's pulled them up. She went, I ended up with a 4-inch square of Bryan Island burnt right in the bar. She says, but don't tell MD. So, a wee while later, she came to see me and she went, see you. I'm really too good. I went, never done nothing. She says she was in the toll booth in Glasgow Cross. I think she was at the court or something. And she's went into the toll booth for a pint. And it was a guy stoning and he went, I've never seen you in here before, hen. She went, no, I don't usually drink in here more than for one. He said, I don't know your face. She went, no, but I ain't so. He says, where do you usually drink? She went, oh, you wouldn't notice. She said, it's a gay bar. I go up to you know, Austin's in Hope Street. He went, oh, I go there on a Saturday afternoon with my wife to see that Robert May Miller. I went, oh, we were in a fortnight ago and she was talking to some daft lass that been the burnt or our something. So as my sister Jim says, if you've not got anything good to say about MD, sit with us. Oh, mother of God.
Hi everyone, it's Michelle McManus here. I'm sorry to interrupt your evening because of course you're having a fabulous time. You're being entertained by the icons that are Robert and Mae Miller.
That's why.
And if you just take a moment to say how incredible that finally Mae Miller is doing her much anticipated one woman show. Marvellous. Can we have a round of applause for that? Message. Me and Robert are doing something really exciting this year in between Christmas and New Year. You know, it's always that time when you're not quite sure what to do with yourself. Well, we've got the perfect excuse for you to go out and party. Robert and Mae Miller are doing an evening with, and I'm really honoured to be their special guest on the night. So if you like what you see tonight, which I know you will, we're going to be doing a show with great music, great chat. I probably have a couple of Christmas numbers in there too as we get ready to see Hugmania in just a few days later. So it's on the 28th and 29th of December in the East Kilbride Village Theatre. Get your tickets. Mae will no doubt have tickets on her. If not, when you're leaving the Arts Centre tonight, stop off at reception and ask the girls there. They'll be able to give you information about the website and the box office number that you can call. So if you're looking for something to do in between Christmas and New Year, and let's be honest, there'll be plenty of swally as well, it's us, you know what we're like. Make sure you come and see An Evening with Robert and Mae Miller featuring Michelle McManus. Right, enough of me, I'll shut it, I know my place, it's not my night. Back to the gorgeous Mae Miller, I don't even start me about how skinny she's looking by the way, I'm going to have to seriously get my acting gear. Enjoy the rest of your night and I hope to see you all during Christmas and New Year. Love you, bye. Bye.
Tell you stuff to finish, but I think my mouth pals are ready, don't I? I don't think I've got anything else to tell you. I think I'll maybe let you go to the bar and I'm going for a kind of fresh orange will come in. Thank you very much, everybody, for coming here tonight. I was a bag of nerves, but for me, I don't know about you, but for me, this has been marvellous. Thanks, Betty. Thanks, Betty, and very, very, very much. I know I've spoke a lot of rubbish for years and years and years, but this tonight, thank you for being sober and listening to it, because usually I just like drunk people that don't know what day of the week it is. But I had a lot of encouragement today. This Michelle McManus encouraged me very much. A lot of other people in here did. I'd like to thank Kerr up there in the box, and for Raymond, the manager, and all the staff in here. They've been feeding us for 3 days, and I'm demented because last year I ate everything for 2 plates of soup. To my wingman here. Yay! I've done anything myself for like 30 years or something. I mean, you're still there. Oh, I forgot again, didn't I? See, this is, oh, no, I forgot. I'm allowed to forget something. See, when I tell you about the song When He Cries that Robert wrote, a couple of years ago, it was Christmas cards coming through the door, and I picked it up and I thought, who do you know in Monaco? You didn't get a letter from Monaco? He never answered me. This came through the door. They'll know that whole thing. That envelope and that weekend. This to address to Mr. Robert Miller. I'm not eating out my dress in case anybody's doing a screws my house. This is from Victoria Setapasi, the personal assistant to Dame Shirley Bassey. And it says, dear Robert, Dame Shirley loves your song very much. Unfortunately, at the moment, there are no recordings scheduled, but it will be kept on file for future reference.
What's going on?
No, it's Nibby. But then you're going to be a millionaire and I could become a cleaner and I don't need good men, that's myself. Any part-time job in the morning. I could clean a shirt bank, I could clean a merchant print. No cleaning the Waterloo. Oh, they used to do things in Lavi. But anyway! The man that has pushed and pushed and pushed me for the last... Well, since we did the vagina monologue to be back in February, and said to me, you can do this, you can do this. Please, please, and he's got a gaffy zuck, so I shouted him down last night, he told me not to do it tonight. But he's got a new shirt on. please give it up for Liam Dolan.